Hello viewers, this is an educational video in which we will discuss fundamentals of HVAC services in buildings. In this video, we will learn terminology related to HVAC, we will try to understand basics of HVAC, we will know what is TR, ton of refrigeration, we will understand types of fans, we will discuss HVAC systems, we will know more the configuration of air handling unit, we will touch what exactly a chiller plant is. We will discuss something about the ductwork and very little about the HVAC drawings. Air conditioning can be defined as the process of treating air so as to control simultaneously its temperature, humidity, purity, distribution in the room, air movement in the room or the hall, and pressure to meet the requirements of the conditioned space. Psychometry is the science involving thermodynamic properties of moist air and the effect of atmospheric moisture on materials and human comfort. It also includes methods of controlling thermal properties of moist air. A psychometric chart is a graphical representation of the thermodynamic properties of moist air. If two properties are known, all the other properties can be determined with the help of psychometric chart. At x-axis, we indicate dry bulb temperature. At y-axis, we indicate relative humidity. And this curvilinear line, it indicates the wet bulb temperature. So if two properties are known, we can determine the third one, and we use this psychometric chart in design of HVAC systems. National Building Code of India suggests thermal comfort conditions in view of three elements of climate, that is dry bulb temperature or the ambient temperature, relative humidity, and the wind speed in meter per second. For an example, if dry bulb temperature is 30 degrees centigrade and relative humidity is 60%, then only a mild wind speed 0.06 meter per second is sufficient to provide us thermal comfort conditions. Whereas at 30 degrees centigrade DBT, when relative humidity is very high, that is about 90%, then wind speed of 0.85 meter per second will provide us almost the similar comfort conditions. Another example can be understood if the dry bulb temperature is 34 degrees centigrade and relative humidity is 40%, then a wind speed of 2.72 meter per second is adequate to create thermal comfort conditions for us. We do not consider wind speed more than 3.2 meter per second because this will provide velocity discomfort to the occupants. Indoor air quality refers to the nature of conditioned air that circulates throughout the space or area where we live, we work, we study, or we play. IAQ is the quality of air we breathe when we are indoors. There are some common indoor air pollutants. These are airborne particles from diesel, exhaust, dust, smoke, etc. These are indoor formaldehydes or VOCs, volatile organic compounds from building materials, furniture, cooking or smoking. These are household odors and gases from activities such as painting, cooking or smoking. These are ozone from outdoor air. Ground level ozone is harmful to breathe. Carbon dioxide from people exhaling and cooking. Sick building syndrome is a term which is used to describe the presence of acute non-specific symptoms in the majority of people caused by working in buildings with an adverse indoor environment. These symptoms are usually short-term and experienced immediately after exposure and may disappear when we leave the building. These are headache, sore throat, respiration problems, or maybe stinging eyes. Hydronic systems are water systems that transfer heat to a space or removes heat from a conditioned space or process with hot or chilled water. The water flows through piping that connects a chiller or the water heater to suitable terminal heat transfer units located at the designated space. Water circulating in a hydronic system may require to be treated to make it usable for air conditioning system due to its effect on the economics and life of the air conditioning plant. Unconditioned water used in the air conditioning system may create problems with equipments such as scale formation in pipes and in equipments, in vessels, corrosion, and organic growth. Supply air is the air that has been passed through the conditioning apparatus and taken through the duct system and distributed in the conditioned space. Return air is the air that is collected from the conditioned space and returned through the conditioning equipment. Recirculated air is the return air that has been passed through the conditioning apparatus before being resupplied to the space. It is called as recirculated. Through this diagram, we will try to understand the composition of an HVAC system, which comprises one inlet for the fresh air, one damper and filters. There is a supply duct. There are heating coil and cooling coils, and depending on the season, either heating or cooling coil may be active. These may be of air based or refrigerant based or water based. So in case of a water based, so this is the supply air pipe, this is the coil, and this is the return water pipe. This is the supply air fan. This is the return air duct, the return air blower, this is the return air, and there should be one outlet for the exhaust air. There should be one damper in between the supply air duct and the return air duct so that the amount of recirculated air can be controlled. HVAC duct is a continuous passageway for the transmission of conditioned air, whereas the duct system may also include duct fittings, dampers, plenums, grills, and diffusers, apart from a network of ducts in the system. A plenum is an air compartment or chamber to which one or more ducts are connected, which forms part of an air distribution system. In this image, we can see this is the duct system, this is the network of duct, and this is the plenum. And in this picture, we can see a box which is known as plenum. It may have circular or rectangular outlets for the connection of air conditioning ducts. Grills and diffusers are the devices fixed in the air conditioning space for distribution of conditioned supply air and return air collected from the conditioned space for recirculation. Fire and smoke dampers are provided in HVAC ductwork in order to control or stop the movement of air across the section of a duct. As per National Building Code of India, fire or smoke dampers are to be installed at particular locations in air ducts, fresh air ducts, and return air ducts. Wherever there is a fire separation wall, where duct enters the vertical shaft, where the duct passes through the floor, or at the inlet of supply air duct and the return air duct of each fire compartment on every floor. Fire separation wall provides complete separation of one building from another or part of a building from another part of the same building to prevent communication of fire from one zone to another zone. If the floor plate or footprint of the building is large enough and more than 750 square meter, then we have to divide the building in two zones and provide one fire separation wall to separate these two zones. In case of a fire hazard which occurs in one zone, should not hamper the life and the property of other zone. National Building Code of India recommends compartmentation area, and all the compartments are to be separated from each other by providing a fire separation wall. For an example, for basement car parking area, one compartmental area should not be more than 3000 square meter. For business buildings, it is also 3000 square meter. For institutional buildings, it is about 1800 square meter. And for all other buildings, one compartment area should not be more than 750 square meter. In HVAC system, we use filters to ensure quality of indoor air. A single filter may not be sufficient to fulfill the function, and a combination of filters may be required to filter various type of impurities like insects or large dust particles, VOCs, smoke, pollens, and hence, if we provide a combination of filter, we can ensure the indoor air quality and fresh air in the indoor environment. There may be some pre-filters. There may be HEPA filters. HEPA stands for High Efficiency Particulate Absorbing Filter or High Efficiency Particulate Air Filters. And activated charcoal layers may be there in filters, which will trap the VOCs. Refrigerant is an important part of HVAC system. It is the fluid used for heat transfer in a refrigerating system, which absorbs heat at a low temperature and low pressure of the fluid and rejects heat at a high temperature and high pressure of the fluid, usually involving changes of physical state of the fluid. Global warming can make our planet and its climate less hospitable and more hostile to human life. It is therefore necessary to reduce emission of greenhouse gases such as carbon dioxide, SOs, NOs, and refrigerants. The potential of a refrigerant to contribute to global warming is called global warming potential of a gas, and it is measured while considering potential of carbon dioxide as a base case. The potential of refrigerant or gases to deplete the ozone in the atmosphere is called ODP or ozone depletion potential of the gas. The ODP values for various refrigerants are mentioned here. Due to high ODP of R11, R12, R22 and R123, their use in the air conditioning and refrigeration is being phased out and more advanced gases like R134 are being used. HVAC stands for heating, ventilation, and air conditioning. Capacity of an air conditioner or HVAC chilling plant is measured in terms of ton of refrigeration. A ton of refrigeration, abbreviated as TR, is defined as the rate of heat transfer. It is the rate of heat transfer that results in the melting of one short ton, that is 2000 pounds or 907 kgs of pure ice at 0 degree centigrade in 24 hours. The value is defined as 12,000 BTU, that is British Thermal Unit per hour, or 3517 watts. For an example, an air conditioner of 1.5 ton, the capacity is 18,000 British Thermal Unit per hour. It is the rate of heat transfer. Determining capacity of an HVAC system for the given case is a complex process, and it is done by the HVAC engineers using certain codes provided by ASHRAE, that is the American Society of Refrigeration and Air Conditioning Engineers, by considering some aspects like air volume of the space, ambient outdoor temperature, solar insulation, number of occupants, type of equipments available in the space, heat gain and heat loss through building envelope, U values of roof, walls, and floor, and ventilation rate required in the space as per the function of the space. We will discuss certain rule of thumb to calculate the TR by volume method for the given case. If we consider the length of the room 14 feet, width of the room 11 feet, and height of the room 10 feet, then total volume of the room becomes 1540 cubic feet. If we divide this figure simply by 1000, so we get 1.54, and we can now consider this 1.54 figure as the estimated TR for that given space. This is just a rule of thumb. However, we have to also consider the other situations, like whether this is the intermediate floor, how much is the window area available, whether the room is available on north side or the south side or the west side. So it can be adjusted, or some factor can be considered to further increase the TR. If the room is located on southwest side or it is located at the topmost story, because solar heat gain would be higher in that case if we are calculating the cooling load. And if we measure the room volume in meters, that is SI system, so we have to divide the volume by 35.28 in order to get the estimated TR. Another example we can consider for the case of a restaurant or a seminar room or conference room or a classroom, where length of the room is 30 feet, width is 24 feet, height is 11 feet. Then hence total volume of the room becomes 7920 cubic feet. And if we divide this figure by 1000, we get a figure of 7.92 TR. So we can safely say that 4 split AC of 2 ton each shall be required for this space. There are various types of air conditioning equipments available in the market. Each type of air conditioner is designed for a certain space and fulfills a certain purpose. The different AC types are central air conditioner, ductless mini split, window air conditioner, portable air conditioner, floor mounted AC, hybrid or dual fuel air conditioner, smart air conditioner, or geothermal air conditioner. We can see different types of air conditioners used in domestic and commercial buildings in this slide. Components and functioning of an air conditioner can be understood with this diagram. Compressor is the heart of the air conditioner, which compresses the refrigerant in the coils. When the refrigerant is compressed, it becomes hot and excess heat is removed by the propeller and dissipated to the ambient environment outside. Then the refrigerant becomes at room temperature, and then it is allowed to release through this expansion valve, and then cooling happens in these coils. Then room air is circulated over these coils in order to get cold air to our room. In case of an split air conditioner, compressor and condenser coil are kept in a separate box and this unit is kept outside. Whereas in indoor unit, there is a filter, there is evaporator or cooling coil, and both the units are connected with the tubes carrying refrigerant in compressed state as well as in the released state. This diagram illustrates the functioning of a centrally air conditioning system, in which the air is conditioned at a central location and is supplied to different rooms within a building through ducts. Different types of central HVAC systems are indicated on this slide. Components of an air handling unit of centrally HVAC system can be understood with this diagram, where there is a fresh air inlet point, there are pre-filters to filter out the coarse particle and insects, etc. This is the preheating coil if required. This is the mixing chamber where return air will be mixed with the fresh air. These are the bag filters or the HEPA filters, which will filter the finest dust particles as well as the microorganisms like bacteria and viruses. This is the cooling coil, and the cooling or heating coil will operate depending on the season and the requirement of the room. Then this is the centrifugal fan, which will blow the air to the supply air duct, and then air will be supplied to the rooms. There are three types of fans generally used in HVAC systems. This is the centrifugal fan, and in all window ACs, we get the cooled air in our room through this fan. This is the axial fan, generally used as exhaust or booster fan in the HVAC ducts. And these are the propeller fans, generally used to dissipate the extra heat generated in the condenser coils to the environment. CFM is an acronym that stands for cubic feet per minute. It is a term used to describe a fan's efficiency in terms of airflow. Determining the CFM of a room is a mathematical process of figuring the room's cubic area as well as the rate at which we desire the air to circulate throughout the room. It depends on the ventilation rate in air changes per hour. Calculating the CFM of a room helps while choosing a fan for our HVAC system. In this image, we are viewing an air handling unit room. This is the AHU. There are supply air duct, return air duct, and fresh air ducts. The AHU is mounted over a pedestal which is a bit raised from the surrounding floor level. This is the supply chilled water line and this is the return water pipe, insulated both. Open weather AHUs can also be mounted on the rooftop, but we need to provide necessary shafts and cutouts in the slab to carry the HVAC ducts downwards. Another image in which we can see that the rooftop AHUs are mounted in sequence over the rooftop of a building. We can learn lessons from this image and can understand why pre-planning of building services is very much important at the building planning stage. It is the responsibility of the architect to conceptualize and envisage the building service requirements for the given building and provide adequate space to facilitate particular building services like HVAC or electrical panel rooms. Many of the times it is observed that architects do not provide adequate space to facilitate the HVAC services. Either AHU room location is not strategic or AHU room size provided is very small in which AHUs cannot be installed. Architects should gather fairly good idea about the size of HVAC rooms and they should plan HVAC room strategically so that duct network can be facilitated across the building at different floors. AHU rooms have certain specific requirements like provision of drainage points or the drain, because chilled water will be supplied to the rooms and there may be some leakages, or moisture or droplets can be generated by the condensation of the cold air over the surface of the HVAC ducts. AHU rooms generate a lot of vibrations, so in order to avoid transmission of any noise from the AHU room to the surrounding usable areas, it is important that all the walls of AHU rooms are provided with acoustic insulation and made soundproof, as well as doors provided in the AHU room should be of adequate size so that they can facilitate the movement of HVAC while it is being installed. Some architectural aspects to be considered while planning AHU rooms are provision of drain or drain points near AHUs, provision of fresh air supply to room through louvered openings, provision of acoustical treatment on walls so that noise does not affect the surrounding areas. We should provide noise proof doors of enough width of 1.5 to 1.8 meters so that movement of large equipments can be facilitated. We should mount AHUs over rubber or polystyrene or neoprene pads so that vibrations are absorbed and they do not transmit any vibration or noise to the lower floors. And shafts or cutouts in the slabs to be planned judiciously to facilitate HVAC ducts installation across the floors as per design. HVAC system designs become more sophisticated when it comes to microbiological lab or biotech facilities. In biotech and pharmaceutical manufacturing units, HVAC system is designed to achieve a particular class of clean rooms in the facility where medicines are manufactured. And so as the case of microbiological lab is. Clean room design in itself is a separate and specialized domain of building typology and architectural design, where HVAC system design plays a significant role. In operation theaters, HEPA filters are provided in the HVAC system in order to ensure the quality of indoor air while maintaining the laminar airflow over the operation table zone. In this image, we can see that diffusers are provided in order to ensure the laminar airflow and air is filtered through HEPA filters. Interested viewers can study further in order to know more the modalities associated with HVAC system design for clean rooms, for hospitals, for industrial applications, for warehouses, and for other different uses. It would be worthwhile to understand the components of a central HVAC system again to gather more understanding. If we see this diagram, there is a fresh air inlet through which outdoor air shall be taken to the system. There is a provision of damper so that movement of air can be controlled. This is the supply air duct, and this part is known as the AHU, in which the filters, the heating coil and the cooling coil and the supply fan is mounted. There is a provision of cooling coil in which chilled water will be supplied. There is a provision of heating coil in which heated water will be supplied. And either of the coil will operate depending on the season and the temperature requirements. There is a provision of supply air fan, a centrifugal fan, which will blow the air to the supply air duct network. This is the return air section in which air will be returned to the section. There is a provision of centrifugal fan or the booster fan. Some part of the air is to be exhausted and some part of the air to be mixed again with the fresh air so that cooling load or heating load over the HVAC system is reduced. So in this diagram, we can understand the functioning and the components of HVAC system in a very simplified manner. Nowadays, there is a concept of dual duct HVAC system also, in which hot air and cold air is supplied in different ducts to the different zones of a building. Interested viewers may explore further in order to know more about dual duct system. It would be worthwhile to revise what exactly the AHU is and what does it comprise. An AHU comprises the filters, preheating coil or heating coil, cooling coil, mixing chamber and supply air fan, and this becomes the AHU in a centrally air conditioned system. In low rise buildings, AHUs can be mounted on the terrace. However, we have to provide necessary cutouts and shafts to facilitate layout of HVAC ducts across the floors. We need chilled water in our coils in AHU so that we can get the cool air by passing the air over these coils. But from where we get the chilled water? We get chilled water from the chilling plant or the chillers, which is a significant aspect of central HVAC system design. This is the diagram of a typical chiller in which there is a provision of a sprinkling of water from the top. There is a blower fan mounted at the top of the chiller unit, and air can be circulated from top to bottom because this exhaust fan will suck the inside air and will throw it to the atmosphere. And by the evaporative cooling, we get the chilled water collected at the bottom of this chilling tower. Chilling plant consumes significant space, and architects and engineers should plan this chilling plant location judiciously. It's not only the AHU or the chiller unit which makes the HVAC system work, but there are so many other devices are associated in the HVAC system. Like there are so many pumps, there are so many valves, there are supply line, there are return line, there is insulation associated over the chilled water supply lines and the return lines. So an HVAC engineer has to struggle a lot in order to deal with all such equipments and devices in order to make the HVAC system work. We can realize the magnitude of pipe work associated with the HVAC system in this image. HVAC ductwork fabrication in itself is a specialized task and requires specialized skills, design as well as fabrication skills. And as we learn the joints in carpentry, there are many types of joints used in HVAC ductwork, like straight duct, mitered band, right, variable band, branch duct, there are offset transitions, beveled junctions, there are vertical ducts, and supply air duct is indicated with cross like this, whereas return air duct is indicated only with a spline line. This is the indicative diagram of a centrally air conditioned domestic unit in which AHU is placed at a central location and all the rooms are connected with the ductwork. In large buildings, HVAC engineers design the system and prepare all drawings like duct layouts and fabrication drawings together with piping layout and diagrams. Architects are responsible to facilitate all building services including HVAC by making provision of adequate space for the ducts and pipes. AHU room should be planned judiciously with adequate floor space, and architectural aspects like sound insulation, drain points, wall openings, slab cutouts, and shafts are to be considered appropriately in the building design. Building design is a teamwork where architects and engineers have to work together as a team with flawless coordination. I am sure the viewers have got necessary inputs and insight about HVAC services in buildings through this video. Stay safe and healthy. Thank you.